Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? I trust that your reorientation to the American way of life is coming along smoothly. Good, good. How are those franks and beans? Good? Good. How about those deviled eggs, huh? And how about that apple pie? Good? Great. God, it's good to have you people back. All right. Are there any further questions? Yes.
Sir, what is Mount St. Helens?
That's a good question. The question was, for those of you who didn't hear, what is Mount St. Helens? Anybody? You.
Is it a candy bar?
No, it's not a candy bar. Anybody else? Anybody? Okay. Mount St. Helens is an active volcano located in the state of Washington. All right. Are there any more questions? Okay, then let's begin. Ladies and gentlemen, most of you are suffering from post-crisis depression. Now, we ran up against this sort of thing in Korea, in Vietnam, and we think that we can solve it. Think we can help you out, get your spirits to fly once again. You betcha. Captain?
I'm so glad to see you all. Oh, that fool's fit for a king, huh? Here, king, here, king. Shut it. Milton Berle, 1912.
I'm so glad to be here. My grandson was supposed to come along. My grandson's 25. He complains about headaches, headaches. I've told him 1,000 times, when you jump out of bed, it's feet first. Thank you, kind. Nice to see you. See you later.
Well, I'm glad you're feeling well, because now we're going to show you something that's really going to help you reorient your spirits towards the American way.
What do you mean?
Well, son, we're going to show you something you've never seen before.
What's that?
Why, an episode of Fridays.
What's Fridays?
It's Friday, starring Mark Blankfield, Meredith Burrell, Melanie Chartoff, Larry David, Daryl Igus, Brandis Kemp, Bruce Mahler, Michael Richards, and a special appearance by REO Speedwagon!
I don't know why they put crap like that on television and take off good, decent shows like Donnie and Marie.
Hey, how about this big news week we've been having? I'll tell you, in addition to the hostages being released, we have a brand new president. How about that? If you're called something 70 years old, brand new. But did you see the inaugural gala Monday night? All the big stars were there, and it was quite a lavish affair. In fact, Bob Hope said it was the first time he had ever played a coronation. Crown of King there. Never mind. And of course, they were three great black performers at the gala, which is two more blacks than were in the audience. I like that one.
Tell me, dear. Yes. Does it ever bother you that some people don't take you seriously enough?
Well, Mommy, if we can't laugh at our president, then who can we laugh at? You know, it's... Now! As someone once said, malicious ridicule is the highest form of flattery. Yes? What? Oh, very well. Send him up. George Bush is here. He wants to see me.
Now?
Well, he said it was important.
Oh, I'd better change.
Mr. President, I'm sorry to disturb you at this hour.
George, is everything all right?
I just couldn't sleep. I'm scared.
Well, what are you scared of, George?
Well,
I thought you were going to change.
Well, I did change, dear. My other nightgown was a Bill Blass. This is a Galanos.
Mr. President,
yes.
I'm scared of the responsibility we have. People are putting their trust, people of America are putting their trust in us. What if we fail?
Well, George, yes? All right, now? Well, send him up. Alexander Haig is here. He's on his way up.
Oh, I'd better change.
Now, George, what we have to do is face up to this challenge, you see. We can't be put off by it.
I
understand your fear, though. Any man who isn't frightened by this kind of power would have to be a lunatic of some sort.
Ah, this is exciting, isn't it? I see you boys couldn't sleep either. I just took a stroll down to the war room to have a look at the big board. I love it. All those little red lights, and each one a 30 megaton surprise for Mr. Bolshevik.
Al, what are you doing here at this hour?
Higgins! Gentlemen, this is an aerial view of the embassy in Tehran. I can land 6 copters with 20 combat-ready troops in each here on the recreation field. And under the cover of darkness, I will rush the main storage area, and I'll get them all out of there before they know what hit them.
What the hell are you talking about? They are out.
The hostages, yes, but not their luggage.
Who cares about their luggage?
America does, Mr. President. Or didn't you watch Nightline tonight? Luggage held hostage, day 3.
The general is right, Mr. President. We can't go through that humiliation again. Bags held hostage, day 250, day 350, day 450.
Now, the way I figure it, we will have to accept 50 to 60% casualties, but it's worth the price.
Worth the price? Hey, do you hear what you're saying? Human lives for luggage?
American luggage.
What you're talking about, General, is immoral.
I have never knowingly committed an immoral act in my life, Mr. President. Nobody holds a monopoly on virtue. Not even you, Mr. President.
What's she doing here? This stuff is top secret. I never keep any secrets from my mommy. Come on, she'll talk. Shall sing, shall spill all this stinking gust like a man.
Al, it's getting late. We can go over all this in the morning.
Oh, well, let me take it down the wall. I'll show you the big board.
Great,
it's
Al.
Great. And that one put my car. I'll plug it in the satellite.
Well. Well, dear, it certainly has been a busy week, hasn't it?
Yes, certainly has. Boy, where else but in America could an ex-actor like me wind up sleeping in a bed that was once slept in by Abe Lincoln?
Yes. Good night.
Good night, dear.
Dear.
If these four walls could only talk.
Yes.
Ah, well.
I wonder what they'd say.
Four score and 7 years ago.
We have nothing to fear but fear itself.
Not tonight, Pat. I have a headache.
The task of prosperous Americans is to build a great society.
Sleep well, Mr. President. You will need your strength, for the road will be long and the journey hard, and the price of freedom is eternal vigilance.
Want.
You told me to come back in 25 minutes for my birth control pills.
Mm. There are no birth control pills in this pharmacy. I've been looking for the past 25 minutes. They are, I've checked everywhere. They simply are not here. I don't understand what could have happened. What the hell? Birth control pills?
Finally, those are my birth control pills. Now, how much do I owe you?
Oh, $5. Do you hear that noise that sounds like African bongo drums? Huh?
What?
African bongo drums from far away. They're getting louder. Don't you hear them? Okay, all right. Is this Mr. Hart saying hello? A couple of deep breaths. And I can handle it.
I doubt it.
What, thank you for shopping in 24 hours. All right, take a number! With this many people, it's important to stay organized. Okay. Number two.
Hi there, Rick Campbell, Denton Pharmaceuticals.
Denton Pharmaceuticals?! Okay, fine, that's good, because I'm running low. I'm almost out of everything. I mean, look at this. Empty. I can't run a drugstore without pills, and they take away my license for that.
Well, I'm here to help you solve that problem.
Right! You're the salesman, I'm the buyer. Salesman, buyer.
Right, now, as you know, Denton Pharmaceuticals...
Look out! Did you just see that red and green blue flashing?
What?
Ricocheted off the walls, and then...
What?
Okay, no, all right, never mind. It must be me, because you would have seen that.
Now, as you know, Denton Pharmaceuticals has, what we've done is we've just introduced a new line of antidepressants.
Oh, no!
Yeah, with the biggest difference being the price. Mm. Now, you can pass the savings along to your customers, or you can put the few extra pennies in your pocket.
Are there any cobwebs on my face? Okay. Because, boy, it sure feels like it. Okay. There are no cobwebs all over my head.
If you like, I can just leave a few samples with you.
I can't try these right now. Let me check my supplies. I think I need a few things. Let's see. I need these. I need some of these and these.
What?
Okay. Cancel the calls. Everything's under control. I can handle it. Okay. Hi. Can I help you?
Listen, I'm just going to go in your stockroom and make out a tentative order.
I need to get that filled. They're for diet pills.
Oh, yeah. Beautiful. We have these. Black and beautiful.
Now, if I take these, will I be able to sleep?
Let me tell you something about sleep. I haven't slept since 1973, and look at me. Alert, perceptive, razor sharp. What do you need sleep for? Anyway, you know, you just lie there in the dark doing nothing. And, you know what? Sleep makes you tired. That's right. Can you imagine never having to sleep? What a concept.
I just want to lose a little weight.
Well, take a pill. Don't be unhappy. Don't be a martyr. Take a pill. We got pills here. Keep you smiling for weeks. And it's all been inspected by government officials who wear rubber gloves. Don't be afraid. It's socially accepted. Just take a pill. Why don't people wise up? Why can't people be what they want to be and just take a pill? Bell!
Well, if you'll just give me it, I will.
Shh! There is a shoplifter. Don't turn around. There is a shoplifter in the store. Don't turn around. I've got to catch him by surprise.
I'll come back for that later.
Easy. Don't lose your head. All right, I've got you. All right, I'll call the cops.
Police!
All right, okay, call the cops. Get out of here. We'll never come back. Oh, I hate him. Drug salesman. Hey, I need more pills. This is a pharmacy. I'm a pharmacist. They're trying to put me out of business. What is this stuff? I've never seen it before. I'm almost out of everything. Oh, no. Oh. Back in business. I'll take some of these. I can handle it. I can handle it.
This is the Friday edition with your correspondent, Melanie Chardoff.
I'm Melanie Chardoff, and good evening. These are tonight's top stories. Former President Carter advised Ronald Reagan to abide by the hostage agreement, but to never do any favors for the hoodlums who persecuted innocent Americans. President Reagan immediately signed an executive order making it a crime for any American to do the following favors for Iran. 1, pick up Iran's laundry. 2, give Iran a ride to work when its car won't start. 3, loan Iran a lawnmower or power tools. 4, give Iran a couple numbers from our stash when they're running low. In a related story, Former heavyweight champion Muhammad Ali this week talked a would-be jumper down from a building after the man threatened to kill himself because he was a nobody. Ali, pictured here with a distraught soul, said, "I just told him that things were bound to get better, and that man just cheered right up." Well, President Ronald Reagan is pretty upset that his inauguration was overshadowed by the release of the hostages. To help soothe that president's anger, the White House announced today that Reagan will be re-inaugurated next Thursday at 8 p.m. Now that the hostages are free, it appears that many Americans are also jumping on the hostage bandwagon, claiming that they, too, were also hostages in Iran. "I was a hostage," stated 30-year-old Ronald Winwood of Napa, New Mexico. "I snuck out of Tehran in the middle of the night and walked to Turkey undetected." Mr. Winwood plans to write a book, a movie, and a television sitcom about his experiences entitled, "I Was a Hostage, But I Just Can't Prove It." Good news for the United States of America. It was announced this week that for the fifth year in a row, the USA was voted the hippest country in the world. Our first runner-up was hip Ethiopia. Residents of the little town of Queechy, Vermont, were horrified by what appeared to be a meeting of the Ku Klux Klan happening right within their very community. However, upon closer inspection, relieved townsfolk found it was only a meeting of the Theta Theta Thetas, a group having an intense hatred of the letter T. And now, with another film review, here is Friday's entertainment critic, Larry David. Larry?
Thank you, Melanie. Last night, I attended the premiere of one of the most exciting films to reach the screen in years, Island of the Wild Babysitters. The film features newcomer Candy Kane, who brings incredible dimension and sensitivity to the role of Tracy Selfish, the insatiable babysitter. This movie was unbelievable. It starts off with Tracy Selfish and her boyfriend, okay? They come home from school, and they tell Tracy's mom that they're going into the den to study for a big exam. So they get into the den. The next thing I know, they're going at it like maniacs. I thought I was gonna have a heart attack. All of a sudden, Tracy's mother walks in and catches them and says to Tracy, "What are you doing?" And she says, "They're studying." "Yeah, sure, yeah, they're studying, yeah, yeah." She's sweating like a bandit, yeah. Yeah, she's doing a lot of studying, yeah. I couldn't believe she got caught. She should've locked the door. Of course, the stupid mother should have knocked. I hate it when people don't knock. So then the mother throws Stan out, and Tracy has to leave for her babysitting job. She works as a babysitter, okay? So she goes and she knocks on our neighbor's door where she's gonna babysit. I'm going, why can't that be me? Why can't a babysitter ever knock on my door?
Larry, I want to thank you very much for that enlightening
So he takes her into the living room, okay? Okay, now Tracy comes into the living room with the guy she's babysitting for, and before you know it, the two of them start right in. All right, so they go on for a while. Then they finish, and the guy's wife suddenly comes in. Just walks into the room. She's a nurse. All right, now, okay. I got a clip. I'm gonna show you a clip of this. This is when the nurse comes into the room. This is after they've finished. The nurse is his wife. Okay, let's pick it up. There's the guy. He says to her, "She's all yours." That's what he says to his wife about Tracy. So she's going over to the bed now. She sits down, she says to Tracy, "If you don't do anything, I won't let you babysit anymore." Now watch Tracy. We'll look at Tracy. She doesn't want to do anything. She goes, "Okay, I'll do it." But I felt sorry for Tracy Selfish. I mean, she's lying there, and the guy, the husband, says to his wife, "She's all yours." First of all, how can he assume that Tracy would do a thing like that? And frankly, I don't think there's any way to talk to his wife. No hello, nothing. She's all yours.
Larry, thank you very much.
Let me tell you, this movie, the acting was great. It's fantastic. Go see it. You can't go wrong. I'm telling you.
Larry, why don't you tell our audience where that film is playing? At local theaters or?
Oh, well, I saw it at my friend's house.
Once again, for another informative review. Thank you. And now a personal note. Well, Super Bowl 15 is just a few days away, and millions of Americans are anxiously awaiting Super Bowl Sunday. Well, I have a little confession to make. To be honest with all of you, I really don't care that much about the Super Bowl. I mean, I don't care at all, actually, not even the littlest itty-bitty bit. As a matter of fact, I just couldn't care less about the Super Bowl. And yet so many Americans and so many people just care so much. Does this mean that there's something wrong with me? I mean, am I somehow dispassionate, cold, inadequate, humorless, maybe? I mean, why am I not excited by the concept of heavily padded grown-up men trying to just knock each other down so brutally just to get the skin of a pig? I feel so alone in this. I feel so cut off. I feel so unloving and so un-American. Oh, well, I'm Melanie Chardoff. Have a good Super Bowl weekend.
This has been the Friday edition with your correspondent, Melanie Chardoff.
And now, REO Speedwagon!
So you think you're that you got him all figured out? He's a sweet token stud who can bend a girl's heart with his pout. He's the kind of lover that the ladies dream about. Oh, yes, he is. He's got plenty of care.
back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Maxwell Klitschke. And right now, I'd like to bring up our wonderful impressionist, Mr. Al Giuliani, a wonderfully talented man. So, Al, what were you doing last night? You smell like fish. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. For my first impression, Cary Grant. Judy. Laugh, it's funny. They really take your guts out in this business. Finally, James Cagney. You dirty rat. I'm gonna give it to you like you gave it to my sister. Thank you.
I want to see Henny.
Lucy, you're in the next sketch. Will you get out?
Jack, please. It's my only opportunity. I've studied the man all my life. Please, he's a holy man. I've studied his books. I bought them in the store. Look, his holy words. I'm familiar with everything he's ever said. Guy goes into a doctor's office. He says, Doctor, I have a ringing in my ears. What should I do? Doctor says, don't answer it. Please, Jack, please.
Did Henny say that?
Yes.
Get in there, man. Get in there. He deserves it. Get in there.
Nose drops?
His did.
She had a coming out party, but they made her come back in again.
I don't know what makes you tick, but I hope it's a time bomb.
That's my subject. Yes, questions, answers. I answer every question
Mr.
exactly.
Mr. Youngman.
I answer every question exactly, but not correctly.
The meaning of life.
Pleasure. I just came back from a pleasure trip. Took my mother-in-law to the airport.
Henny,
yes.
The whole world is against me.
Just have a price on your head. Take it. Take my advice.
Thank you, Henny.
I've spoken.
Henny, what's wrong with me?
There's only one thing wrong with you. You're visible.
Thank you, Henny. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh.
I think it's time
Henny,
to go on.
Henny!
Yes, sorry. Yes. Yeah. Right, I can't hold them out there much longer. Please, they want
to. They're ready for me. I'm set.
Yeah, ready.
Yeah. Yes. Kid, I didn't have a penny to my name. I forgot the joke. I didn't have a penny to my name once. So I changed my name, that's all.
Henny, yes, I enjoy making love all night long, but I feel terrible in the morning.
Well, sleep till noon.
Thank you, Henny, it hurts when I do that.
Don't do that.
Oh, Henny, thank
Henny.
Yes.
I haven't tasted food for a week.
Don't worry, it tastes the same.
Oh, thank you.
Every man has a certain woman, so take my wife, please. Can you hear that crowd?
Henny.
I need the world of these people. You know the conditions. The
world.
Yes,
thank you for talking to me, Henny.
Yes, it's a pleasure.
Henny.
It's a pleasure. I've rested my mind for a week, thank you.
Henny. I saw you at Christmas in South Paulsburg in 1957.
I know it. I can't forget that dress. I remember it.
Oh, thank you, Henny.
Henny. Yes.
How did the porcupine make love?
Porcupine makes love very carefully. Thank you very much. I wish my mother was here. My mother was 88 years old, never used glasses, drank right out of the bottle. My mother knew I was doing this for a living, she'd kill me. She thinks I'm selling dope here. So. I had my mother in a Carnegie Deli in New York, and I was sitting there with her, and all of a sudden I found a man's hand in my pocket. I said, what do you want? He said, I want a match. I said, why don't you ask for it? I don't talk to strangers. Celebration all around tonight, folks. You're looking at a fella tonight who's been married for 52 years to the same woman. Where have I failed? Where have I failed? I take my wife everywhere, but she finds a way home. Take my wife, please. We went back to the same hotel while we got married. Had the same suite of rooms. Only this time I went in the bathroom and cried. I said to my wife, where do you want to go for your anniversary? She said, I want to go somewhere I've never been before. I said, try the kitchen. People ask, how did it last so long? Here's a secret. My wife and I go to a lovely restaurant like the Boston Half Shell twice a week. A little candlelight, a little wine. She goes Tuesdays, I go Fridays. Met a friend of mine, Irving Wells. I said, what, you look bad. What's the matter with you? He said, I lost three wives in the last 3 months. What happened? He said, my first wife died from eating poison mushrooms. What happened to your second wife? She died from eating poison mushrooms. What happened to your third wife? Fractured skull. How come? She wouldn't eat the
poison mushrooms!
I'm glad you're laughing. I went to a wonderful doctor out here. Gave a man 6 months to live, couldn't pay his bill, gave him another 6 months. I said, Dr. Friedman, I have shingles. He tried to sell me aluminum siding. I love it out here. I love it out here. folks. Stay tuned. Stay tuned. We'll be right back, folks. Every man needs a special woman. So take my wife, please. We'll be right back. We'll be right back. We'll be right back. We'll be right back.
Cable Channel 73, your cable television station de Mexico. We are excited to present a new variety show featuring the queen of song and dance and comedy fun, Inez Prado, on El Show de Inez Prado.
To the festival in Guadalupe, and I sat there for half an hour entranced and enthralled by everything and everybody. And I remember Papa said to me, Inez, look up there. And my eyes gazed upward, and I saw Toto, the flying acrobat, and grabbed for the bar and began to fly, leap, and twirl. And I said to myself, someday you will go into the city and buy everything in the department store I wanted.
are you doing the rest of your life? Not until the knees and left of your life. I have only one request of your life, that you spend it all with. Yo, 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 yo.
I'm Larry David. I'd like to thank Henny Youngman and REO Speedwagon for being with us. Next week, May 1st, we're taking off. The Kentucky Derby special is going to be on. And in 2 weeks, on May 8th, we'll be back with a surprise guest star and a special appearance by Jimmy Buffett. And for the first time, the show will be 90 minutes, not 70, 90 minutes. Yes, 90. An hour and a half. We have to fill an hour and a half.
You're going to make us work for an hour and a half?
Okay.
More.